I am pleased to be joined by the 61st mayor of Atlanta, Andre Dickens. Thank you so much for being here and thanks for joining us. I know you've worked on the city council before you were elected last year for a couple of different terms. You've worked in the nonprofit sector. You've worked as a business person. You're a dad, a deacon. The dad's probably the most important part of your jobs here. But I want to ask you, you recently held a series of town meetings around Atlanta. And I want to hear kind of what was it? What were the primary concerns that people were telling you about? Because so much of, at least in the past month or so, we've heard kind of high level complaints and concerns in the national election cycle. But what are people on the ground in Atlanta telling you, the mayor, that they need changes around?
Yeah, well, first, thank you for having me on. I'm delighted to be here to talk about mayors and cities across America. I sit on a number of committees at the United States Mayors Conference and Conference of Mayors, and we talk about a lot of things that are happening in our cities. And so Atlanta, I decided to have three town hall meetings in three parts of town over a couple of weeks to give citizens and business owners and clergy, et cetera, the opportunity to talk directly with me and my senior leadership. And they had a broad array of questions and discussions. Some were, thank you, Mayor. We're happy to be back doing great things together. I saw this project get done. I see that. But then there were still things around public safety, conversations they wanted to have about feeling safe, about making sure we have more housing for our unhoused residents. And also infrastructure projects. People want to see roads get paved and sidewalks get repaired and those sort of things. So it was a mixed bag, you know. And the thing that also happened there, Hari, is the public, you know, got civics lessons, essentially learning what this branch of government does versus that branch. You know, the mayor is the person they see on TV every day in their city or in the newspaper. So If the United States government changes a post office location, they ask the mayor about it. Right. You know, things that are national issues, gun control, abortion, those things, they still ask the mayor about it. What are we going to do about this issue or the Supreme Court or cases? And, you know, we chime in where we can and say that we have a voice and an interest, but also letting them know, hey, this is federal, this is state, this is local, this is judicial, et cetera. But it was great. People needed to get their message out and also see what we're doing to bring down violent crime as well as uplift opportunities for people on the ground.
You know, you have made housing one of the kind of central pillars of the platform that you ran on. And now that you are the mayor, tell me a little bit about how you plan to tackle the housing challenges in a city. I think officially you might have a 500,000 in the city limits, but probably let's say the 5 or 6 million that you have in the greater Atlanta area that you kind of feel responsible for. And I know there's a lot of other mayors around other cities that are also faced with housing challenges.
Yeah, you're right. Atlanta is a 500,000 people, a little bit more than that, but 6 million in the metro Atlanta region that people, you know, and we're the heartbeat of that region as the city. And, you know, housing is a challenge. The cost of housing has risen something like 75% since 2010, but people's incomes have only increased in the working class about 10 to 12%. So at some point, a lot of people continue to find themselves cost burdened, where they have more month than money. And essentially the cost of housing rising at 70% means that if you were paying $1,000 a month for rent or mortgage, now you're at $1,700. And has your salary kept up with that? So my goal is to build or preserve 20,000 units of affordable housing over the next 8 years. And so far this year, we've already cut ribbon and allowed people to move into 1,700 plus units. And we're still doing more. I'll be going to a ribbon cutting tomorrow on housing. So we're doing that. And we got about 3,900 units in the funding cycle or in construction. So we're on our way towards 20,000 units. But the truth of the matter is we have a housing supply shortage. So we're building housing. And one of the things that we have is just a high amount of demand. This city is a victim of our own success. People continue to want to move to Atlanta, as we were just listed as the best place in the United States to live. We have these great colleges and universities that people keep graduating out of, and they need a place to live. So what we're doing is trying to build more housing, and we want to do development without displacement. We need our legacy residents, these senior citizens, the people that's lived here 20, 30 years, to be able to manage the growth that's happening. And so we're taking care of some rent stabilization and trying to overcome their increase in property value that associates with the increase in taxation for them. So trying to overcome that too.
So how do you add the number of affordable housing units that you want to add to try to tackle the unhoused? Do you do zoning changes? I mean, because a lot of times people are for affordable housing until they realize this could be a block away from mine, and then they automatically perceive this as a decrease in their own property value. So how do you have those conversations?
Hari, you are, you know, speaking my language or bowling down my lane, as people say. I will tell you, most of my job as being mayor is managing competing interests, right? People, their interests are, we want to help those people that are our firefighters, police officers, school teachers, those that are, you know, nurses, or even those folks that are experiencing homelessness, but they don't always want to do it next door to them. And so the city is blessed with the ability to make those tough decisions, but also we have a lot of vacant land. We have a lot of land that is owned by our school system, our Rapid Transit Authority, our Housing Authority, as well as HUD. The federal government has land. We have about 1,000+ acres of land that we are now actively incentivizing development to occur. And that development will be mixed income development, where the principal, the school teacher, and the janitor or school bus driver can live in the same community, pay different amounts for a different size of home or apartment or condo, but be able to have the same amenities and access to a great school in these areas. So we're about to redevelop areas of town that have had limited investment over the past few decades. And so we're going to do we're doing aggressive campaign towards incentivizing development. The other thing that we're doing is we do have inclusionary zoning, which I was the author of in 2016, that took effect in 2018, that requires any new development around our Beltline and other areas where we've made significant investment. Those areas are required to have 10 to 15% of their units set aside for workforce housing. And so we've seen the benefits of that policy take place to where we have units coming online. But it's policy, as well as public-private partnerships, and just diving in to establish that this city is going to be a city for everyone. I'll even give you one last example. There was a dilapidated apartment complex that I put $9.1 million in to move people out of this horrible complex called Forest Cove. People were living there in third world or less conditions. And now we've gotten about 800 people in this year. We moved them out of those horrible conditions into safe, dry, warm, yet still affordable places to live. And now we're about to redevelop that area, bring those people back and others, so that this full community can take place.
You know, finally, I want to ask you, when you had these town hall meetings and otherwise, when you, let's say, talk about crime and safety, right? I mean, you have perhaps one segment of the population saying, hey, I would like to have more police on the streets. I'd like to feel safer in that way. And you also have another segment of the population who might also want public safety, but they might have a greater distrust of the police that are on those streets. And there's kind of numerous examples we don't need to go into, but how do you have that conversation between different communities who want the same thing? They want to feel safer, but perhaps they might have different ideas of who can help them feel safer.
Yeah, that's a delicate walk to take for sure. You have to have a balanced approach to safety and justice. You're right. There's, you know, we're having a COVID crime wave still across America. People are still feeling the effects of COVID, this public health crisis where folks have not learned to resolve conflicts without going to a gun or a knife or fighting over it. You know, we've seen that in our city. So many of our homicides are what we call escalated disputes or domestic violence. And so we as a nation have had a tremendous, deficit that occurred over COVID that has led to isolation and depression. And so there's very real concern about people's safety. But we've opened back up the city. We're providing safety and folks to be able to get through COVID and be able to have interactions. So we're utilizing our parks, utilizing our green space, making sure we add more lighting on our streets by, you know, adding additional street lights. We have more cameras on buildings and places that can connect to our police camera network so that we can, you know, give assurance that you're being in a safe environment. So, you know, crime won't happen in these areas because they know they're being watched. So we're using environmental tactics to bring down crime that doesn't require a police officer, because a light or a camera operates 24 hours a day versus a police officer. We're also doing police tactics, though, hiring more police officers, incentivizing them with more pay, but training them in a 21st century way of how to be good community-based police officers, talking to the residents, knocking on doors. But we do have to deal with violent crime. So we're really making sure that our officers are focused on violent repeat offenders and bringing down gangs, guns, and drug offenders. So drug distributors. So I think that, you know, taking the right approach to make sure that we go at it a balanced way, we've been able to see some significant decreases in some of our areas of you know, crimes against people, and you know, doing so without getting ourselves into the you know, excessive use of force category.
You know, you mentioned crimes from COVID continuing. And I wonder, I mean, you took this job in the middle of a pandemic. And when you looked at the numbers of what was happening to the city of Atlanta, the economy, the jobs, who was working where, tell me, where are you now on that kind of that comeback, if you will? I mean, for a lot of at least white collar workers, they still have some of the options of working from home part time or full time. What does that do to the sort of downtown or commercial corridors where, if there are not people back in the buildings, the person who's making the sandwiches or the taco truck down the street, they're not going to get money either. So where are you in that conversation with business people? And what are you seeing in the numbers of how Atlanta's economy is doing?
Yeah, I was serving as a city council member during COVID, working alongside our dynamic mayor, Keisha Lance Bottoms, who, you know, had to be the mayor during the height of COVID. And so, you know, as I became mayor, starting in January, we were able to make some decisions that were tough, but couldn't have been made as easily last year as we made them this year, which was a return to work at a hybrid work environment for the first half of the year. And then now we're even more towards back in person, because we had a limited amount. We had people, you know, City Hall was virtually closed. People needed things that they wanted to get, from permitting to paying bills to some other activities, so they could talk to their government. So we had to get those services open. We had to pick up garbage on the schedule again every week. So we were now, you know, immediately as I took office, we got garbage service picked up. We got transportation going. We have some things that we improved upon, but we're still watching numbers and trying to make sure that we still stay COVID safe. We keep an eye on it. The CDC is in Atlanta, so we have a direct connect to a lot of those folks and our advisors of health. So, you know, coming out of COVID, or, you know, getting into this phase, we're working together and drawing a circle instead of drawing a line. And that means bringing folks together to solve these things together, working with the state, the county, and the city to make quality decisions about what we do next. And we've benefited from it. You know, people have gone back to work. Businesses are thriving. You can't get a restaurant seat on a Friday night without calling ahead, or a Saturday night. And we want everyone to fully participate in this. So what I've seen is, you know, we still have people on the fringes that we have to get training to get good jobs so that we can have them fully participate in this society.
Mayor Andre Dickens from the City of Atlanta, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Hari. I appreciate it.